Hare Krishna, everyone. Hare Krishna. Okay, I hope you've all had a very nice meal. And welcome to, I've just found out that these aren't called alumni jammings. I used to call them alumni jammings. They're called alumnites. See what you did there? Alumnites. So this is a very, very cool evening because, you see, alumnites are for very cool people. It's for the over 25s that want to live a very dynamic spiritual life, that would like to nurture their Krishna consciousness together, connect, network, and really grow together. It's all uphill from here. So I hope you really enjoy today. I just wanted to start with gratitude. And what's this other hot word that keeps going around? Gratitude and being in the present. So if anyone here is thinking that they should be anywhere else today, don't, because this is the most perfect place to be. And let me just explain why. Because right now, we are all in the presence of Sri Sri Krishna Balaram. They're just here. You can see we're having their personal darshan. And so we're very blessed, we're very lucky. So in any part of the world, any other thing you could be doing today on Wednesday the 15th of February 2017, this is the place to be. Now, as icing on the cake, we also have His Holiness Sacinandana Swami. His Holiness Sacinandana Swami Ki Jai! How many of you have heard of Maharaj, spoken to him, or listened to his lectures, read his books? Anyone had any connection with Maharaj? Has anyone never met Maharaj before? Doesn't know anything about him just yet? Anyone? Yay! Okay, we've got a few very shy people. Anyone else? Anyone else? Okay, well, I have the pleasure of introducing him to you, and I'm really excited and nervous. I'd like to start with my own personal experience. When I was 16, that's when I first met him. And he was on a Pandavasena trip. It's a youth trip that we had in Germany. It's in 2001. And he spent a lot of time with us, and I was really grateful. Hello. Okay. I was really, really grateful to have that special time with him. And as we've grown older, he's always continuously been there for us as we were youth. And now, as we're a little older, he's come to the different trips that we've done, and now he's come to the alumnite. And we also, and he's just always been there for us. And I'd like to, I started reading up on, because obviously if I'm going to introduce him, I need to find out a little bit more about him. So I checked on Wikipedia, and I found something really interesting. He came to Krishna consciousness, please forgive me if I've made any mistakes and correct me, but he came to Krishna consciousness himself when he was 16. Now, even more interesting is I'm 33, and when he was 33, it seems that he started initiating. He was an initiating spiritual master at my age. I can't believe that. And then 2 years later, he actually took sannyasa. So he renounced everything and became a sannyasi. And since then, he's just been propagating the holy name and sharing Krishna with everyone. I'm sure he was doing that before he took sannyasa as well, but this is his life. And we're really, really grateful. And I'm really excited. So what has he been doing all this time? He's been writing many books. I don't know if you've seen the book table out there. Nectarian Ocean of the Holy Name, I've got to recommend that one because that's my favorite. And The Art of Transformation. And he's got CDs, he's got kirtan CDs. So please have a look at that. He also runs a lot of seminars and workshops and retreats. Oh my God, the Japa retreat and the kirtan retreat, you guys have to go. You just have to. If you want to try anything in Krishna consciousness, you have to try these retreats. They are life transforming. And so on that note, I'd like to introduce you again to His Holiness Sacinandana Swami. Today he'll be talking about life lessons of World War II. He comes from a German family, so he might have some very interesting life lessons for us. So if you could just raise your hands, and we're going to, with full enthusiasm, chant Hari Bol three times. Hari Bol!
Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
Sacinandana Swami ki jai.
Thank you so much by your affectionate enthusiasm. It is very heart-touching to hear you. I'm proud of you. How this could be a TV show. You could very well done. Before I start with the life lessons from the darkness, I would affectionately greet the many known faces. I see also Jan. I happened to go through the notes of your workshop just this morning without knowing that you would be here this evening. Just this morning, I with dignity, everything came back. I also see many of or some of you with whom I cooperate on different projects, and I'm particularly honored also to see the president of the Bhaktivedanta Manor with his right-hand man or left-hand man. Or it's very nice. I have spent a very, very, let me say, inspiring afternoon with Nitesh, discussing on various aspects of spreading spirituality in a systematic way in society and integrating spirituality within the larger society. It was for me very thought-provoking. The word is inspiring. Afternoon discussion. I have just come back from Mother Ganga, the banks of that holy river in Shida Mayapur. I have been part of a really interesting discussion on much the same things which we will look, or which you are looking at in this school system, Avanti school system, that is, again, how to integrate spirituality into the society, and in this way give society the soul back, which it has lost in many aspects. Yes, I'm a pilgrim who has returned, and it is said when one sees a pilgrim who has returned, one will share some of the benefit of his pilgrimage. So today it is beneficial to look at me. Maybe not on other days, I cannot, I don't think so, but today it is good. I say this without any false pride, because I'm carrying the effects of a pilgrimage, and it's that which is of interest for you. So, yes, I want to now turn to the subject of this evening, that is lessons from World War II. I can already announce that some of it, what I will tell from the World War, will be a little difficult, so mothers who are pregnant should not get emotionally involved in that part of my discussion. I do come from, I do have a background of World War II, and that is, I was a child of a very, let me say, repentful German officer in the World War II. My father was recruited into the Hitler army when he was only 16 or 17, the age when I came to spiritual life. He was part of what is called Hitler's youth, where the young Germans were indoctrinated at the time when they were very malleable and influenceable to the value system the Nazis propagated, a value system which is very, very problematic, as history knows. The belief was we are the best, and the best needs space to live. The German word Lebensraum was the justification of the aggressive expansion of the German army. So because these were soldiers who were trained from childhood, who were extremely convinced and aligned with this, we are the best and the best should live on for the good of the world, and therefore must conquer living space or space to live. Because they were so convinced, they were one of the world's most successful armies up to the time when, fortunately, it was stopped. And a turning point happened. There was one particular experience which my father had always told us children, which made him turn around. And it is here where the world war, as ugly as it is, can give us a lesson which I think is relevant to, let me say, not just as a historical analysis of what drove people, but as an advice for modern men and all of us to imbibe in our own lives. The way my father told it is like this. He had just come back from a stunning victory over the Polish army. The Germans had tanks with which they attacked the Poles, who came charging at them with horses, with agricultural instruments like this. Is it called a sichel, which you use to harvest grain, and these not very long range guns. And this battle was fought with only five tanks and a little artillery in the back against thousands of farmers who came with horses and on foot charging towards them. I need to tell you this in some detail so that you understand why, what it was that my father learned. They came charging towards this tank, a majority of people ready to kill the Germans. And the commander of the tank, he took out a pistol and said, "This pistol is now aimed at all of you in the tank. Don't lose your nerves. Let them come close, because we have not so much ammunition. When we shoot, we need to take out a maximum of people out of their life." So all of the people in the tank wanted to fire, of course, from a long range, so that, because it's disturbing if people come closer and closer with only one idea, to kill you. And he said to the commander, said, "If any one of you starts the fire, I will shoot you." So they were sweating it. the poles came closer, 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 closer. They opened the little artillery which they had, and tong, 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 it started to the tanks were not so good like now, good or good equipped like nowadays. They were sweating. And my father said one of his comrades lost his bodily fluids to the law of gravity. They were really losing the nerves. And the commander said, if one of you... I'm determined. I will shoot you. So then when they came close, my father said 30 meters. They were all also so nervous. 20 meters. I will shoot if any one of you starts the fire. 15. And then he said, now shoot. And then, of course, all the explosive took down all the enemies. It was a stunning victory of a few German soldiers over a massive amount of Polish soldiers. They were all exhilarated. They were drunken from the victory. We would say they were almost like the Rakshasas in Ravana's army, the bloodthirsty monsters. Then, after everything was finished and the battlefield was soaked with the blood of the poor Poles, my father and the commander of that unit took a stroll through the Polish forests to go back to the camp where the German camp was. And when they came through the forest, on the same forest path from the front, a beautiful buck approached them with antlers. For meat-eating soldiers, the ideal meal to celebrate victory. So the commander said, he has not noticed us. The wind comes from his side. And he told my father, shoot. Now my father was in the concept that an enemy cannot be considered to have human rights or the rights to live. He is evil and he is to be exterminated. That's how he could kill so many people and be part of that effort of the Nazis. But here came a living being whom he could not identify as an enemy. He couldn't put or integrate the beautiful buck with the antlers into the category of thinking which justified his cruelty. Do you understand what I say? This was not an enemy. This was a living being. This was the father of children. This was a being who had a wife. This was, and he aimed and he said, come on, don't be sentimental, said the commander. My father told to the commander, maybe he also lost a bit of the nerves, if you want, you kill me first. I can't do it. You do it. And the commander took his, he was, commander, his weapon, I don't know what it was it a gun or a pistol? And the antler the buck came closer. He was easy to be killed. It was an easy feat. Then he put it down and he tried again. But he also couldn't see him in the same rationality which justified the killing of, I don't know how many Polish soldiers. Was it 5,000? Was it 10,000? Were it 15,000? You have to look in the history books of war. And then he said this German word, missed. Missed means like an English slang word, which I cannot. It starts with S, H, and then it continues to the rest. He couldn't do it. And he looked at my father and he says, "Don't tell this to anyone." And then they never talked about it. And they went to the camp. My father knew if he would tell the weakness of the commander, the commander would, I don't know what the Germans did with weak commanders. They were not very human with them. And for him, it was the changing point. And he questioned the rationality of war. Was it really that these people he killed and was supposed to continue to kill, that they had no right to live, that they were no living beings? Or were they maybe just like the buck, family heads with hopes and aspirations, affection and so on, just like him? And he had to continue to kill, but he said from that moment he never shot towards the heart but only towards the knees. You understand, they had to continue to shoot, otherwise they were killed by the commanders. He really, and he tried to avoid since that moment any mortal combat, but there were a few things he could not avoid, and so on. He could never really live with what he had done. He sought therapeutic counsel afterwards, but what he always told us, little boys, when we were eating our supper at the family table, is, "Boys, what I have seen is something which I do not wish you to see. I have looked into the abyss of human psychology, and I have seen, and I'm convinced, that there is only a very, very thin border which separates the human being from a dangerous carnivorous animal, like a tiger and so on. And under certain circumstances, the human being is able to cross that border and become so dangerous and overrules his conscience. This we have seen in the recent war in Yugoslavia, where one neighbor turned against his neighbor and shot him just because he learned that that neighbor is an enemy, because he has a different religion, because he has different ancestors who come from different parts of the world, just because of some manipulation, the mind is spoiled, and they have turned also neighbor against neighbor. And it shows to me that there is that what my father said, there's this fine border running through right through our hearts, which we must be aware of, and which we must avoid to cross, the border which separates our higher nature from our lower nature. This border was shown in a was built in a very let me say visible form. It run as the result of the Germans' atrocities through the whole country as the wall. And I would love to talk a little bit about this wall. But I would like to only talk about a section of the wall. That is the wall which runs through Berlin. I remember when Nitesh, and I only know the other talented young men by their spiritual names. It was Siam Gopal, then it was the husband of our talented MC. Then it was Bhuta Bhavana, the famous coach, and so on. When they came, I invited them to come and visit my little lake ashram outside of Berlin. We wanted to just talk with each other because they had invited me to come to the Pandavas, to one of the different projects which they have, the Pandavasenas, and I thought, well, if we are going to cooperate, if we do work together on this, it's nice if we spend a little personal time together and get to know each other, and from this basis it will be easier to form a mastermind so that we can work in the same direction. And they came, and when they came, I wanted to give them an unforgettable experience. We had some nice little workshops and also private time together, and then I took them to the Berlin Wall because I felt the Berlin Wall spells out an unforgettable lesson to what people, especially spiritual people, should avoid: to build walls of interests between each other. This was my desire, and I want to describe to you what the Berlin Wall was like. It was made because the different forces, America, France, Britain, very important force, and others allied together and said, we want to avoid that these Germans ever become strong again, because they are dangerous, they have a dangerous mind. So let us separate the country and divide the country, then their economic growth will be stifled. So they built a wall through Germany. Just to tell you the dimension, only the wall through Berlin was 140 kilometers long. Imagine the rest of Germany. That was only one town. A wall right through the country. It's almost as if we say, we can't work with the Avanti school staff, you know, and some go to the left and the others to the right. Let's build a wall right through the school. It's so crazy. They were so out of wits what to do with the Germans, that they came to such an event. But as it showed and as it developed, the Germans found the wall very good, because half of Germany went towards the communistic bloc and looked for alliance there, and the other were looking towards America and the prosperous West. Now, that communistic part of Germany, the East Germany, which was separated by the wall, had one difficulty. The people who lived in East Germany were deprived of the consumer goods which the people in Western Germany had. There was only one brand of toothpaste, whereas in Western Germany you have 20 brands. And many of the people tried to escape from East to the West, being allured by the higher comforts. And therefore, the Eastern German people began to defend the wall and saying, we will not tolerate if any of our people with whom we will build a communistic oriented state escape our effort. They became defenders of the wall. The wall included large concrete walls, and then before them was the death stripe, which was raked sand or gravel, which made footprints easy to recognize. There were mines underneath the ground, and there were 116 watchtowers in Berlin alone, where armed guards stood and stood guard, so that no East Germans could turn to West Germans. In other words, what was previously directed towards all the other enemies was now directed towards their own people. Do you understand? These guards were ordered to shoot anyone of their own people who tried to run over the death stripe and then scale the wall and escape to so-called to freedom. They were ordered to shoot them, and there was an order. I've written it down for you. Even if those who give up our communistic values and become traitors to the real life go with children on their hand, shoot them, because the enemy, now it's their own people, takes different tricks to escape. Again, the enemy, now the own people. I mean, I have so much information, I don't really want to describe it to you, but I would like to concentrate a little bit on this friend and enemy concept, which all of us need to look at in order to come to the next level of our development. here people who were walled in developed different creative ways to cross over the wall. And here we see how the wall was built. Is this? Yeah. Next slide, please. You get an idea what it looked like. Here. Right through Berlin. Here are the guards. People were trying to scale them, but this was the primitive version. They were later enhanced and so on. Yeah, I'm not sure if we should go more into detail because it's kind of deep. Is it too depressing for you? Or yeah, here is someone who has just stolen uniform and who starts to run through the heavily guarded passages from East to West Germany. He jumps over a barbed fence into freedom. He made it, by the way. Many were shot in the attempt. And so on. When people saw that what was going on, a wall between their own town, a wall which separated people from people, relatives from relatives, a wall which ran through the heart of these, of their own people, they became alarmed. Something has gone wrong in the human being. This is the last picture. Good. I'm a soft-hearted person. If you want, you can put this now out. We don't need this yet. There were and people began to have creative ideas of escape. Horst Klein, for instance, I later met him, used an unused high tension electric cable to go just 60 feet above the guards, hand by hand over the death stripe. And when he finally lost strength, he just swung and hurled himself over the remaining distance. He made a disgraceful descent, but he landed in free West Germany. He had a broken leg afterwards because of sacrilege. Others who wanted to escape freedom, shot an arrow with a very thin line from one window of their house in West Germany to West Germany, and they just somehow climbed over that thin wire. And still others put their shirts together, nailed them together, put a gas burner under them, and with the hot air, built a hot air balloon and floated with it to West Germany. They wanted to cross that border. That is the point. I want to encourage you, when you see this border running through your heart, separating your higher nature with your higher instinct, also make a good escape into freedom. Very important, very important, very important. We as human beings are very, very capable of building borders between us, walls which separate one from the other. These walls are described in the ancient Sanskrit language to be made of the substance of ego, false ego. The false ego says, these are my interests, and anyone who is not following this interest becomes my enemy. It's this ego which runs through every human being, separating our spiritual side from our material side. And it happens and it springs up in not nice ways, even in schools where staff turns against staff. I know it doesn't happen in Avanti schools. It is something which is bound to happen if we cannot awaken to genuine spiritual life. If someone comes to bona fide spiritual insights, he will no longer distinguish and separate others. He will become a well-wishing friend to all. In the Bhagavad Gita, such a person is described as a wise man who doesn't really see a difference even between a dog, a cow, a learned man, and a dog eater. He sees everywhere the same spiritual soul. He does not make a difference, and he feels for others. I, for instance, feel now for Madhava, who is a little tired. I can emphasize. I can see Madhava, the tired man, is just like when I am coming from an international flight and I cannot see any longer, because I see the general principle of the soul, and we are not different from each other. That is the spiritual vision, where this friend and enemy vision, which separates us, goes, where the ego is effectively reduced and finally substituted with a sense of spiritual identity. This is the gift which spiritual practice has to you. And this gift of seeing spiritually, of seeing and appreciating others in a spiritual way, that comes as a byproduct to turning our attention back to the Lord. When the children in this school were asked what they wanted to have in the center of their school, and that is a question which is asked on the architectural level, they said, we want the Lord in the center. And as a result, you see here an altar. It is an architectural demonstration of what is necessary to come to the spiritual level, what is necessary to come to our higher nature, what is necessary to be a real human being who has successfully overcome the border to his lower self, this animal self. That is the important lesson I feel to be taken from World War II. You have to reconnect not with the false ego, the false identity, but you have to look for the Supreme Lord and be in contact with Him. And in that divine contact, you become like a spark who has become charcoal due to falling out of the fire. You return when that charcoal, how do you say in English? Charcoal, is thrown back into the fire. Its luminous quality manifests. He shines. He has a natural effulgence. He has an enthusiasm. He is never exhausted, even when he has to be a teacher. This means to overcome our charcoal nature. It can only be overcome if we reunite the fire, reunite with the fire of the Lord. I want to end today. I have heard that attention span in England is very small. You have to entertain your audience wildly, otherwise it doesn't fly. I want to end with moving insight, which makes clear how turning to Krishna is so absolutely essential and so enlivening. There was a blind poet. His name was Surdas. When his last days approached, and he felt that soon he would depart this world, he requested his disciples to carry him to the banks of the sacred river Jamuna. And there he turned, he wanted to give up his life remembering Krishna. But what he did is he turned from the back position where he lied on his back to the front position where he was lying on his belly, his face into the dust of Vrindavan. So when he was lying there, waiting for his chariot to come and bring him onwards, a great devotee appeared there and saw him lying in this unusual position. And he said, "If it is not disturbing you at this last moment, then please tell me why you have turned your face in this direction." But Surdas didn't want to talk about himself and remained silent to this question. So the great devotee felt, let me ask then another question, because I want to hear the wisdom of the parting saint. Can I ask another question? Can you please speak about your realization of our Lord? And then Surdas answered, but he didn't speak, he answered in song. I've heard this from a reliable source who is sitting amongst us and smiles a smile of recognition. Our Yaravinda. Surdas said, "I will just glorify one aspect of our Lord's glory, that is his generous nature. My Lord," he sang, "is extremely grave, since his thoughts are occupied with how to free the living entities from the bondage of illusion. He's sitting like the king in the hearts of all, and he is thus aware of every small thought in the kingdom of the heart. He's the king of everyone's heart. Even if his devotee has only a tiny fraction of a good quality, he magnifies that quality, and in his mind, this quality becomes as big as Mountain Meru. But when you have something small, the Lord thinks, wow, wow, so wonderful, my devotee. My Madhva is so wonderful. He likes kirtan. On the other hand, if he sees the offenses of his devotees, even if they are as great as the ocean, he hesitates to take them into account. And he prefers to see them as insignificant as a tiny drop of water. Next Surdas, this was now, he had glorified the Lord. Then he turned, he remained lying where he was in his position, but he addressed his listeners. Always remember the Lord in this way. He is continuously smiling and stays right by the side of every single one of his devotees. No matter in which direction the devotee turns, the Lord is always next to him. Sometimes people ask me, how can I improve my spiritual practice? I'm so diverted. Facebook takes all my energy. That they say in London. And I say, just remember when you chant, when you worship, when you sing, whatever you do, the Lord is just standing next to you, smiling at you. Then you will give up your distraction. Even, now it gets dramatic, if the devotee should turn his face completely away from the Lord, he does not feel even for a moment, now I should deny him my mercy. When realizing his mistake, the devotee turns back to the Lord. He finds the Lord smiling just like before. As soon as the Lord finds the devotee separated from him, he becomes obsessed with the desire to give his kripa or mercy to him. When I published this, when I heard this and I noted it down, I had to ask the translator, Yadavendra, obsessed? Is that the right word? The Lord has his private obsession? That's what normal people have. No, he said, you must understand. Surdas wants to express here, when the Lord sees that someone is separated from him, he doesn't see him as an enemy. He has no wall. He just wants to do everything to bring that person and to give this person his mercy. He wants to do everything. It's an obsession. It occupies him entirely. The Lord constantly follows the devotee, moving to and fro to attract his attention. And then Surdas answered the question. He said, if at his last moment Surdas should turn away from the Lord, there's no one more unfortunate than him. To explain this last section, the Suddhas thought the Lord has walked on this ground of Vrindavan. His lotus feet are there. And in some spiritual way, the land of Vrindavan is identical with our Lord. Therefore, I want to turn to him and roll from my backside to my front side so that I'm facing him directly. There is a spiritual law, my dear devotees, my dear friends, and all the tired Englishmen who have worked so passionately throughout the day. There is a law. In association with something higher, you are uplifted. In association with sweet mango juice, ordinary water also takes on the sweet, juicy qualities. In association with a good web page and a fantastic mobile app, let me talk more modern language, London-wise, you become uplifted. It's the effect of association. So by associating or turning towards Krishna, our lower qualities go. I know if all the Germans would not have sang Heil Hitler or Glory to Hitler, but if they would have said Jai Sri Krishna, glory and turned towards Krishna, I know the border in the heart, which is so much separating one against the other, making this dangerous vision, which was the cause of World War II, the psychological cause, enemy and friend, would not have been there. And my father was recruited, was transformed, when he was supposed to kill the buck with the antlers in the forest of Poland, and could not see him as an enemy any longer, but saw him as a living being, a soul just like him. And that made all the difference. Maybe that is why his son became a monk. It's an unlikely combination. He was highly ranked because he joined very early the army, and he then wanted to make good his faults by becoming, his way was, I will help the Germans to rise, but not in a bad way. I will take care of the train system, which will transport economic goods and people who can meet each other. And he became a director of the German railway, not the only one of 24. He wanted me to become also like this, but I became like this. It is better. I thank you very much. I have ended here. Now comes the most wonderful part. Do you have any questions to this part? Lessons from World War II. Yes, I'm looking at... okay, let us start with Abhishek.
Thank you for the wonderful class, Maharaj. My question was, you were speaking about how when your father had that moment in his life where he saw the buck, that kind of was like a wake-up call for him, where he started seeing the buck as a living entity. Mm-hmm. Do we need to have that sort of wake-up call in our life? And how do we kind of get that for ourselves?
Uh, be very realistic and frank. Wake-up calls are very good. And many of us who have not yet come to a turning point in their lives need one. But if they wish to have it, and they wish to progress, then they will come marching into the life one after the other. If the Lord sees that we are eager, He will give us just what we need. But if He sees that we want to forget, He will give us also the facility to forget. Another way, which is not so painful, to wake up. You know, a wake-up call can be quite dramatic at times, is to associate with saintly people, and in their association you come to the turning point. Because you see they are so different from me, and it does something with you on the deepest level of your core beliefs. I want to be like that. I remember when I came from Brussels, when I flew last time to England, I was in the airport and I was singing in my mind the kirtan. And I came to a group of five people or so. Two or three were heavily armed, there were security guards in the airport, and two were just staff workers. And they stopped me and said, "You look so content. What are you doing?" I said, "I'm going to the toilet." We can talk afterwards. There's some urgent call I have to respond to. And then afterwards I said, at the end of our discussion, I'm going inside, like in meditation, and I'm meeting inside the Lord. I'm doing this by singing His holy names. "Wow," they said. And I said, you find out, you can Google this, in the Google Hare Krishna temple, and then they can tell you more about it, and so on. And I think when they said that "wow," you know, that innocent wow of which accompanies a new discovery, it was maybe because they met someone who is living the spiritual life. I mean, I'm not a good example, but something I do. So when you want to come to a turning point and start a new life, have good association. That's why we organize retreats. It's all for the purpose of association. We had one recently, the Avanti teacher retreat in the Buckland Hall, and I was told that from the feedback, everyone seemed to like it very much, and because it does give new impulses. But let us be very thoughtful. If you want to see them, there are hints and signposts almost on every single meter of your life's journey. You just need to look with alertness. Thank you, Abhishek.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. I'm so sorry to be the mean one, but we have.
You're
to
the time factor, isn't it? No problem.
Would you be able to lead kirtan?
Yes.
Until 9:30.
Yes.
I'm so sorry. I wish we had an after party so we could all like go somewhere else and have our questions.
We're just getting warm.
I'm so sorry.
Fine. Fine, so I want to now lead all of you in the singing of the holy names. You came in at a very good moment, because this is what we were just talking about. I think we should end this evening, this wonderful evening in this wonderful school, which has taken all my traumata from my previous German school experiences away. with a nice kirtan, where we sing together, and we will cross. I think no one has to cross the border now, but it will help us to be in contact with Krishna. We want to create a very nice spiritual sound vibration of the holy name here in this school, which is very, which is endearing to the Lord. Are you familiar with the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra? Everyone here who is not, please raise your hand. Everyone. Good. I request you all to sit up a little. You can use the backrest of your chair. Let us reflect about the song of the blind poem, which was all about turning really to the Lord. In kirtan we do this, we turn towards the Lord. It's a conscious effort opposed to mechanic singing. Deeper. Krishna, Krishna, Hare, Hare.
Krishna, Hare, Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare, Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama,
my dear teachers, I will, and dear alumnis, dear guests, I have a question for you. Are you still thinking? Are you still switched off to the spiritual reality? Or are you already singing or turning towards the Lord? See, it's so important to get from one side, that is the material way of functioning, into the spiritual side, that is the spiritual way of functioning. And for that you need to connect with what you do. Please connect with the singing. It will be very good for all of us. We will build strengths in all of us, spiritual strengths. Please sing now. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare.
from your heart, please. Yes, very good. One more time, please. Hare Krishna. Everybody, one more time, please.
And we will sing again, this time. Without instrumentation, we will really sing and we will hear ourselves singing. We will hear the voice of the soul turning to its Lord. Please join me.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare, Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
And one more time, as if you really mean it.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Thank you very, very, very much indeed. If I should condensate what I want to say, is that the lesson of the world war, at least for an individual, was that you need to cross that border of the ego, of selfish interest, in order to see everyone equally and no longer divide them into friends and enemies. From this maturity comes so many blessings and so much inner strength. Now this massive task to come to the spiritual level is very easy if you learn three words. Turn to Krishna. Or if you are not a worshipper of Krishna, turn to the Lord. He's there in the heart and he's waiting for this. And I believe you already know it. So turn to the Lord. And singing kirtan is one of the ways. I wish you all the best in this effort. I'm delighted to be in this, in your association. It is always a wonderful treat to see what you create. You are revolutionaries, spiritual revolutionary. Maybe this sounds not so good in English. You're pioneers, and you have something unique, a format that will integrate spiritual society, spiritual principles into society at large. I didn't speak a format which will integrate a particular religion into society at large. I said a format which will integrate a spiritual principle, that's something as universal as the air we need to live by, that will integrate that into society. And I wish you all the best. I was speaking today with our Nitesh, and I could see his forward vision, this vision which moves forward. I think this is a blessed effort which you do, and you will see miracles unfolding in your own life. Please give your best, but know that what you have in mind is a pioneer work which will be successful with divine grace, ultimately with divine grace, not only our own strengths. So, because that's necessary to turn away from that other side in us which is not good and which came out at World War II and wherever war happens. All right, I will not talk any longer, to not give our talented MC a headache. How to stop the Swami? No problem, I'm finished. Thank you so much. All the best. Hare Krishna.
His Holiness Sacinandana Swami Ki Jai. Thank you so much. That was amazing, wasn't it? That was so good. I loved this subject in history, but I always had a sense of panic, and I was always scared of this. I'm still really scared of this topic. But then you kind of brought us into another space, an internal space of hope and excitement about an internal adventure that we could all possibly go on. So thank you. I feel really peaceful now. So thank you. Today is somebody's birthday. It's His Holiness Sacinandana Swami's birthday. So we're going to sing Happy Birthday. Oh, Hare Krishna. Let's do the Hare Krishna one. Hare Krishna to you. Oh. Hare Krishna to you. Hare Krishna, dear Sacinandana Swami. Hare Krishna to you.
Woo! Thank you so much. How did you find out? It's a carefully concealed secret. Only known by those who check my passport. Thank you so very much, and I'm almost emotional. wonderful. Well, thank you for this friendliness. What should I eat it now in front of all of you? Or
well, is there a knife there? I guess you can cut it, but you don't need to cut it for all of us. Do I have to eat it all at this moment? We've got pre-cut slices over there. Would you like to? It's sign language. Yeah. Okay. We don't blow out candles in Iskon. We do a little.
I think I cut it, and because I just ate a whole feast at my host's place, and I would like to share it with everyone. Is that good? Or I could blow it out, but then you would have the breath of a aging man over your cake, and you don't want that. So I will do this one. But I'm much. This one candle is for every 10 years. I'm not so old. No, I'm joking.
We celebrate the
today is my birthday regarding this sun calendar or Western astrology, but regarding the moon calendar, it was. So we are going by the Vedic astrology, by the moon calendar, and when I was celebrating birthday, I was offered a cake this big, and it was a cake art. It had an archer on it, and a target, and it was an illustration of good kirtan, where you point your attention towards the Lord, much like an archer aims an arrow. And it was cake art, have to see the pictures. Yes, so what will I do, Vrindakumari? Not Vrindakumari, you are Vrindavan Vinodini, almost?
Vrindakishori.
Even better, yes.
We'll have a few words by Nitesh Gore, aka Naveen Krishna, Das, if you'd like to come and say a few words for me.
Whilst Maharaj is cutting the cake, I'll just briefly just say a few words, if that's okay, Maharaj.
Yes, please.
I think maybe somebody can take this from him now. He doesn't need to cut the whole cake. I was telling Maharaj on the drive to the school that I had a recent seminar by Bhaktivedanta Maharaj. And Bhaktivedanta Maharaj was talking about two different types of faith based on a relatively recent philosopher called Eric Fromm. And he was saying there's a material faith and there's a spiritual faith. And the material faith is the externalization of faith, and we possess it like we possess things. So we possess material objects and we possess faith in the same way. And spiritual faith is more aligned to the words that we use for faith in Sanskrit, which are Shraddha or Vishwas, which are one's life breath or where one places one's heart, reflecting the point that actually spiritual faith is not something that we possess or something that we externalize, but is actually something that is ourselves, it's our very being. And when I was thinking about that seminar that Maharaj was giving, I was thinking actually Sacinandana Maharaj is like a real kind of personification of this spiritual faith, because when I interact with him and I speak to him and have the good fortune of doing that, then it becomes clear that this person is not interested in the external trappings of faith and religiosity for the sake of the external trappings, but his focus and his attention and his conversation always comes down to the point of how much are we experiencing Krishna consciousness? How much are we experiencing spiritual life? How much is it actually part of us as opposed to outside of us? And that focus is so enriching and refreshing to hear from a spiritual leader. And we are extremely grateful for your constant reminder and focus in bringing us back to what's important around how much are we actually developing in our spiritual lives. So thank you so much, Maharaj, for all that you give to us and guide us. And tomorrow, Maharaj, is for those fortunate people who are coming along with us, going on another retreat to Buckland with about 150 of the Pandavasena. So lucky us. So thank you once again, Maharaj, and wishing you a happy birthday.
Thank you.